The Gangs of New York, An Informal History of the New York Underworld, by Herbert Asbury, unabridged. Narrated by Peter Lerman. This text was first published in 1927 and is currently in the public domain. This recording is copyrighted in the year 2023 by Bull Mouse Publishing House. Introduction. This book is not a sociological treatise and makes no pretense of offering solutions for the social, economic, and criminological problems presented by the gangs. Nor does it aim to interpret and analyze the gangster in the modern "I think he thought" manner by conducting the reader into the innermost recesses of his mind and there observing the operation of his scant mental equipment. On the contrary, it is an attempt to chronicle the more spectacular exploits of the refractory citizen who was a dangerous nuisance in New York for almost 100 years, with a sufficient indication of his background of vice, poverty, and political corruption to make him understandable. Happily, he has now passed from the metropolitan scene, and for nearly half a score of years has existed mainly in the lively imaginations of industrious journalists, among whom the tradition of the gangster has more lives than the proverbial cat. Nothing has ever provided more or better copy than his turbulent doings, and hopeful reporters continue to resurrect him every time there is a mysterious killing in the slum districts or among the white lights of Broadway. No matter how obvious the crime being rooted in bootlegging, dope peddling, or whatnot, it is hailed as a new gang murder. Words and phrases which have grown hoary and infirm in the service are trundled out and dusted off, and next morning shriek to a delighted populace that there is blood on the face of the moon and a new gang war impends. But the conflict never materializes, and it is quite unlikely that it ever will again. For there are now no gangs in New York, and no gangsters in the sense that the word has come into common use. In his day, the gangster flourished under the protection and manipulation of the crooked politician to whom he was an invaluable ally at election time. But his day has simply passed. Improved social, economic, and educational conditions have lessened the number of recruits, and the organized gangs have been clubbed out of existence by the police, who have always been prompt to inaugurate repressive campaigns when permitted to do so by their political masters. Inspector Alexander S. Williams gave the gangs the first downward push when he enunciated and put into practice his famous dictum that there is more law in the end of a policeman's nightstick than in a decision of the Supreme Court. And their decline continued as decency invaded politics and an enraged citizenry protested against wholesale brawling and slugging. The gangs were definitely on the run when John Poroy Mitchell was elected mayor on a reform ticket in 1914, and his commissioners of police, Douglas I. McKay and Arthur Woods, completed the rout by sending to prison some 300 gangsters, including many of the shining lights of the underworld. It is true that there remain small groups which occasionally take in vain such mighty names as the Gophers, Hudson Dusters, and Gas Housers, but they are no more gangs than an armed rabble is an army. They are merely young hoodlums who seek to take advantage of ancient reputations. Within the past few years, there have also arisen various combinations of young criminals, such as the Crybabies, Cake Eaters, and the bands captained by Cowboy Tesler and Richard Reese Whitmore, all of which have been called gangs in the news stories. But while some of the old-time gangs could muster as many as 1,000 members, none of these recent groups comprised more than half a dozen, and none was able to operate more than a few months before it was dispersed by the police and its leaders sent to prison or the electric chair. They had nothing in common with such great brawling, thieving gangs as the Dead Rabbits, Bowery Boys, Eastmans, Gophers, and Five Pointers. They were more nearly akin to the bands of professional burglars and bank robbers who infested the metropolis soon after the Civil War. In the underworld, such groups are not even known as gangs. They are called mobs, the difference being that a mob is composed of only a few men, seldom more than six or eight, who combine for a specific series of robberies or other crimes and have no particular adhesion or loyalty to their leader. They are gunmen and burglars, but none of their killings and stealings have anything to do with gang rivalry or questions of gang jurisdiction. And brawling and rough-and-tumble fighting is quite foreign to the nature of such genteel thugs. Their operations lack the spectacularity of the deeds of the old-timers.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.